in the editing and publishing aspect of it, but I've started it about 25 years ago when my daughter was about 2 years old, and I decided that I need to document our journey from Vietnam. I was born in Vietnam, and we left in 1975. In fact, the anniversary of the fall of Saigon is coming up April 30th. So this book also commemorates the 42nd anniversary of the fall of Saigon. So originally I wrote it for my children. So last year I resigned my job with the purpose of focusing on editing and getting my book published. So here it is. It is published and it is available on Amazon. In paperback and Kindle. And before I forget, I wanted to let you know that it's very exciting to be offering this promotion that you can go online and go to Amazon.com and type in TigerFish, and my book should pop up, or TigerFish, comma, a memoir, and you can download it for free on me, and you can download it. Pass along the word, spread the word, and because the promotion ends on midnight on Sunday, this coming Sunday. So go out there, download as many copies. Well, you can only download one, but spread the word so that more people would know about the book and read. So it is available on Amazon and paperback and Kindle. It is also available on my website. My website is chibeingchi.com. It's spelled CHI, which is my name. Being is BEING and then CHI. So go to my website and you can order a copy if you want me to autograph it. Otherwise, you can just go to Amazon and get the book there. But I highly encourage you to go as soon as we're done here, download the free copy and then spread the words. So, I wanted to touch upon why I wrote the book, which I talked about. I wrote it for my children, but the reason why I wanted to focus on publishing it is because I feel like the story, my refugee experience story, no longer belongs just to me and my family. It belongs to the wider world because of the political climate right now, and I just want to raise awareness and bring attention to the issue of refugees, to have compassion and an understanding what it means to be a refugee. So my book is 276 pages, and I invite you to travel along, with me on my journey to have an understanding what it means to be a refugee. Nobody chooses to be a refugee. We do it for self-preservation, to avoid persecution. Basically, I'm just inviting you to read it and have an understanding, a firsthand account of my firsthand account on what it was like for me growing up in Vietnam and coming over, and all the ensuing challenges of acculturation and assimilation. So, again, if you're just tuning in, TigerFish on Amazon or my website, chibeingchi.com. And, I invite you to look at the pages they have on there on Amazon to preview it, but especially don't take my word. Read the reviews that are left there by the readers, and a lot of them are extremely heartfelt. And when I wrote the book, I had no idea. When you're a writer, you focus on the words and you pour out your heart. And until they're readers, you don't know how it's being perceived. So when I receive the reviews, it's extremely heartfelt, and I wanted to thank the reviewers for that. So basically, that's what I wanted to talk to you about. I wanted to, let's see, there, if there are any questions, I could address, let me see, Tatiana said, so timely, most people don't understand how it's like to move to a different country, even in peaceful times. I can't even imagine being plucked out of your country and leaving everything behind. So very good observation and question, I mean, a statement, because right now it's all about globalization. Even though you're not a refugee or immigrant, because of the economy, the global economy, a lot of people do travel, do work in different countries. So the book is relatable on that level, is that you don't have to be a refugee to understand or relate to what it means to live in a different country, try to fit in, try to understand, try to observe the culture. And there's a lot of minutiae, a lot of things that, you know, I didn't get until, you know, years and years later. So, and then let's see. So it's quite challenging, even if you're not a refugee. I mean, I used to work at the governor's office of emergency services in California, and I served the population of disasters, refugees. They didn't choose to be disasters refugees. You know, fires happen, earthquake happens. And so, you know, you can relate on that level. And see, let's see. Tatiana also said, in one part of the book, you encounter that American soldier. How was that first impression for you? I think she's a reader, so I think she was talking about when I was waiting for my ride home, and an American GI, but he was in civilian clothes, and he came up and wanted to take a picture of us, and he said something. I don't, you know, obviously didn't speak English then, but he just sat down in front of us and took pictures. And in Vietnam, it's a monoethnic culture, so we're all Asian. And so for us, Americans were very formidable. They're big people, and you know, we all have black hair and brown eyes, and to see somebody with different eye colors and bigger stature and just the whole demeanor, it's a mixed feeling. I mean, it was I was intimidated, but I was also fascinated. So it left a huge impression on me, because it's you know, not every day that I, you know, Vietnamese back in those days in the 70s, not or 60s even, that we would come across an American that's in civilian clothes. So I was quite fascinated. Let's see. She also said it's such a powerful image, because sometimes we see Americans in our countries as these intimidating people, even when they're friendly. It's true. It's you know, it's all about your presence. And so if a person come across as friendly, you know, you can always tell. But even though they're not intimidating to me, it's just they're, and of course, keeping in mind, I was probably about 8 when I first met a real life American. So, you know, they're bigger, and they usually, you know, they usually spoke pretty loudly. So, yeah, it was quite intimidating, even though that was not the intent. Also, she said, before leaving Vietnam, how was the decision made? Did your parents sit everybody down, explain to all the kids, or did he simply said, gotta go? Well, great question. So when you live in a war-torn country, it's understood. It's understood that life preservation is everything, right? And so we observed things were developing. And even as children, we knew, we had a sense that the urgency for leaving was, you know, it was pretty high on the priority level, that we need to leave to preserve a life, because my father was a colonel in the South Vietnamese Army, and it would not be good, to say the least, you know. We probably, well, read my book, because I don't want to give too much away here, but so the answer is no, he didn't sit us down and say, this is what we're going to do, because that was what we're hoping. We all wanted to leave first. Again, I don't want to give too much away, but the answer is no, we didn't have a say in what's going to happen. Our father basically said, no, let's go, you know. And we got pretty good at last moment's notice. Just like here, when I work at the emergency offices, I have a go bag. I could be ready like in a minute, you know, it's there. So being a refugee really helped me with my job at the, you know, at Cal OES, because at moment's notice, I could be activated and report to work. So let's see. Thank you for sharing your lovely story. Still hoping for a movie again. Yes, let's get this book rolling. But thank you very much. So those are great questions. And so again, I encourage you to go to Amazon and read the reviews for yourself, because these reviews are extremely heartfelt. But the majority of them would say that by reading the book, it was like it was like for them to travel on the journey with me. And that was my intention, is to to take you along on my journey. You know, it's a deeply personal story, and it's one that I feel that you would enjoy greatly. And again, you know, with this political climate, I think that it's very timely, and you get a lot out of it. So I hope that's my intention. So again, I want to thank you for your interest in tuning in and finding out more about me. So the third Facebook Live I will have is tomorrow. It's Saturday at 2:05, and that's during an official launch party at my personal home. So that's when I will read a little excerpt, but we'll just see, you know, it's fluid, and but my intention is to read an excerpt. So if you want to tune in, and I invite you to tune in and you know, participate in this conversation with me and others as well, because I feel like it's a national conversation, and it's more robust and it's more meaningful if it's a two-way conversation. So I invite you to connect with me. I have, you know, my social media information is on my website and also on my Facebook author page, which is, you know, facebook.com/ Being Chi. So that's where you can find me.